It's now time for Mark Hankins, Faith for Every Nation. Mark and Trina train and equip leaders in every nation through church services, leadership conferences, mission trips, and media. Get ready for a direct and joyful message about how to grow in your faith and learn more about who you are in Christ. Now, let's join Mark and Trina.
So yes. We're studying on faith in the blood, and I love to study about the blood of Christ, the blood of Jesus. And so there's no better book on it than the Bible. So turn in your Bible to Romans chapter 3 and verse 21 through 27. We're looking at a particular phrase in Romans 3:25. And so Romans chapter 3 and verse 21 through 27, if you have your Bible, go ahead and just turn there to Romans 3:21 through 27. And right now, I'm just going to read these verses to you, and if you can listen or if you have your Bible, Romans 3:21 says, "But now the righteousness of God without the law is manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ unto all and upon all them that believe, for there is no difference, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." One translation says, "All have sinned and lost the divine glory they were meant to have." So the plan of redemption is to restore that glory. So verse 24 says, "Being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus." Verse 25, "Whom God has sent forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood." So I want you just to underline that in your Bible, through faith in his blood. What do you think about that?
I like that.
I like the phrase. It's just like, bam, it jumps right off the page. Through faith in his blood.
It's effective. It's working.
Wow. Through faith in his blood. And so he says, "To declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are passed through the patience of God." Verse 26, "To declare," I said, "this time his righteousness, that he," God, "is righteous, and he is also the righteousness of whoever believes in Jesus." Wow. Verse 27, "Where is boasting then? It is excluded. By what law? Of works? No, but by the law of faith." So we're looking at faith in the blood of Jesus, and faith, we're looking at the law of faith.
Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So as you're hearing the word of God concerning the blood, our faith is going to
your confidence, your faith, your assurance. And so really, we'd like to start off, as we're continuing here, is a quote here from Andrew Murray, who said that faith is largely dependent upon knowledge. He said, "If knowledge of what the blood can or has accomplished is not accurate, then your faith expects little. The more powerful effects of the blood would be limited. Feeble ideas of its power prevent the deeper and more perfect manifestations of its effects. As we find out what the scriptures teach about the blood, we will see that faith in that blood can produce greater results in us than we have yet known. And in the future, a ceaseless blessing may be ours." Wow. I like that.
Oh, a ceaseless blessing.
Yeah. So to have faith in the blood, he said, you study the scriptures, he said, because faith is largely dependent upon knowledge. Mm-hmm. So we're going to look at the scriptures about faith, about what the blood of Jesus has done for us, and our faith, our confidence in that blood. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Through the blood covenant.
Amen.
Through the blood of the everlasting covenant, that God is working in us that which is well-pleasing in his sight through faith in the blood of Christ.
And the title of this book is The Bloodline of a Champion. And Mark, I remember you preaching this message about a horse, a line of horse, a thoroughbred horse. And you were following that bloodline of that particular horse.
Yeah.
He was called American Pharoah.
Yeah.
And he had won the 2015 Triple Crown title for the thoroughbred racehorses.
Yeah.
And so that meant that he had won several races, the Kentucky Derby, the Preakness, and the Belmont Stakes.
Yeah.
He had to win three in a year. And this horse had done that. But it wasn't just happen chance.
Yeah.
He was in the bloodline of a championship breed of horses.
He was in the bloodline of Secretariat.
Secretariat.
And so Secretariat was the most amazing racehorse ever. And so Secretariat, and in the bloodline, they listed like in one of the horse races there was like five in that one race that were descendants of Secretariat.
Secretariat.
So the bloodline is what makes that horse so valuable and expensive. And so when you make Jesus the Lord of your life, you're in that bloodline of
you
a champion.
You come from a bloodline of champions. Blood,
the blood of Jesus. And so your donor, Jesus Christ, is a champion, and you get his blood.
Wow. So championship is in your bloodline.
Yeah, wow, it's amazing.
You're a winner from the very beginning.
Yeah.
From the very moment you make Jesus the Lord of your life, and we have made Jesus our Lord, we are not in, just trying to make it status, but we are in championship status. So we should say that. I'm a champion.
We are
I'm
more,
in the bloodline of a champion.
More than conquerors through
just
him.
Just think of who our champion is.
Who loved us. Jesus is Lord.
He has overcome. He has already won.
Think about the power of the blood of Christ.
Yeah.
What that blood has done in heaven, then that blood, through the power of the Holy Spirit, also does that in the heart of the believer.
Just like those little colts that were born to the bloodline, you know.
Yeah.
They were sired by this championship,
yeah.
you know.
Yeah.
They look at that little colt, just a little frail little thing. Is,
yeah.
With those spindly legs and
leg
stuff.
Legs shaking and stuff.
And they go, that's a champion. And that's the way God looks at us.
And, you know, we've seen some of those racehorse, big ranches, you know.
Right? Yeah.
And some of those racehorses, I think, live better than a lot of people. I mean, you got a lot of horses worth millions of dollars, and wow.
There's a big investment.
Yeah, when I came back from Kentucky one time, I decided to put one of those kind of fences that they have, those racehorse fences. And so we don't have as big of a ranch. We just have like about 10 acres.
And we don't own a racehorse.
We don't have a racehorse. But I've had a few horses that were not really from the best bloodline. But once they belonged to me, they became a champion. But the bloodline of a champion is really the blood of Christ that flows throughout the body of Christ.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Amen. So through faith in his blood, he says, and so to have faith in the blood, he said, that faith is dependent upon knowledge, accurate knowledge, revelation knowledge of what the scriptures say about the blood of Jesus. So we're going to look at several scriptures of what the blood of Jesus has done for us, what it does in heaven, what it does in our hearts, what it does throughout eternity, and what it does over Satan and over hell and all the strategies of the devil. There is power in that blood, but we have to know, and then we have to apply through faith what Christ has done for us. And then he said, a ceaseless blessing. In other words, we'll overcome through faith in the blood. So let's look at several scriptures on the blood. My favorite, I think, is in Hebrews 9:12.
I think it is. It's a great starting spot.
I like to say it every morning.
Yeah.
Every morning I like to declare.
Just get going.
That living by faith is the chief occupation of our life. And so Hebrews 9:12 says, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but with his own blood, he entered in once into the holy place, and he obtained eternal redemption for us. Hebrews 9:12. So when Jesus was raised from the dead, the first order of business was to take his blood into heaven's holy place. So when Jesus raised from the dead, first order of business is he took his blood into the holy place in the very presence of God. And that blood is there to this day and speaks of the mercies of God. And that blood simply is the redemption that is ours in Christ, and that God sees us through the blood, or God sees us in Christ, which is one of the great phrases used in the Apostle Paul's letters, is now you are in Christ, a new creature in Christ, righteous in Christ. And so the blood of Jesus, first order of business, into heaven, into the holy place. Wow, what must have happened when Jesus entered into the holy place with his own blood, and he obtained eternal redemption for us. One translation says he purchased our freedom with his own blood, and eternal deliverance and eternal redemption through the blood of Jesus once and for all time. He did it for us.
Praise God. So he's made us a peculiar people.
Yeah.
He's made us a show stock breed, so to speak,
yeah.
One translation says. So we are a chosen generation.
Yeah.
Because of his sacrifice, because of his blood that flows in us, that flows from the throne of God, it has recreated us and made us a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation,
wow.
A peculiar people. That so that it brings this praise, and so that we could show forth the praises of him who has called us out of darkness into marvelous light. And so when we receive the power of the blood and when we know about it, we walk in the fullness of 1 Peter 2:9. We're chosen.
Yeah.
We're royal.
Yeah.
We're holy people. We're peculiar. We're not just like everybody else on your street. No, your household, you're covered by the blood. That means you got a blessing on your home. You got your children, you send them out to go to school or you go off to work. You're covered by the blood. No weapon formed against you will prosper. There's power in the blood. So the more that we know what the blood has done for us and it is doing, will do for us, the more confident we have. Confidence.
Yeah. Man. Yeah, through faith in his blood.
Yeah.
So in our family, in growing up, my mom and dad, of course, they taught and preached a lot about the blood, and I didn't understand everything they were doing. But my mama would do what she would say, I plead the blood. I plead the blood. Well, the word plead is a legal term. Mm-hmm. I plead the blood. Like if you were in a court situation standing before a judge, I plead the blood, which means I rest my case on the blood of Christ. Mm-hmm. I plead that blood. That's how I'm going to win this case, is my faith in the blood of Jesus. And so the Holy Spirit has never lost a case if he can get his clients to listen to him.
I like how you said that. Okay, so it sounds like the Holy Spirit is our attorney.
He is our advocate. He's the counsel for the defense. And so the Holy Spirit will prompt you to lift your voice, have faith in the blood, and plead the blood. And so I heard Wigglesworth, in one of his books, Wigglesworth said something like this. He said, the Holy Spirit never brings condemnation. He always reveals the blood of Christ. He is the lifting power in the church today. So the Holy Spirit is not the one who brings condemnation. He is always the lifting power. He always reveals the blood of Christ. He always tells you to turn your attention to the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So my mom would constantly plead the blood, which is a legal term, which is synonymous to faith in the blood. It means the same thing. In other words, Old Testament pleading, New Testament faith in the blood.
Right.
I'm pleading my case. So my mama would constantly say, I plead the blood. Many applications. In other words, many different things are times that my mama would say, I plead the blood. And so when she said, I plead the blood, wow, we've got a really good scripture on that in Isaiah 43. God said, Isaiah 43, 25, 26, he said, I am he. Isaiah 43, 25, 26. God said, I am he that blots out your transgressions for my own sake, and I will not remember your sins. He said, put me in remembrance. Let us plead together. Declare thou that thou mayest be justified. One translation says, put me in remembrance of this promise. In other words, God said, I am he that blots out your transgressions for my own sake. Why? That's so he can bless you just like you never did anything wrong. He said, I do that for my own sake. And he said, and I will not remember your sin. What an amazing promise and prophecy in Isaiah 43. And he said, so now put me in remembrance. Let us plead together. In other words, God is saying, now go ahead and plead or declare, plead your case that you're forgiven, washed, and redeemed by the blood of Jesus.
So he wants us to respond. You know, he says, okay, I'm blotting out your transgressions. Yeah. If it's blotted out,
this
it
is
can't
my
be
promise.
Brought back up. Yeah. It's done. It's over. And then he needs our response. He says, put me in remembrance. He wants you to say, God, you blotted out my transgressions.
Yeah.
You will never accuse me. You're not my accuser. So thank you. And as you speak back to God what he's already done, as it says here, put me in remembrance. Remind me of your merits. I have no merit of my own.
I plead the blood.
My merit is faith in the blood of Jesus. Amen?
I plead.
Set forth your case so that you can be justified.
All right, now, I use Dad Hagin so much because he taught us about faith. And so Dad Hagin said when he came over among the Spirit-filled people, that's where he learned that I plead the blood of Jesus. So he said they would say, in the name of Jesus, I plead the blood. You're facing a challenge or you're facing a situation in your mind or your life. In the name of Jesus, I plead the blood.
What power is there in speaking the name of Jesus?
The name of Jesus, I plead the blood. So Dad Hagin said, it worked so well for me. He said, I still do it to this day. So he said, I got some revelation when I came over among Spirit-filled people. He said, the revelation about the blood of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, I plead the blood. And he said, and I use that against every attack, strategy of Satan. In the name of Jesus, I plead the blood.
Well, Jesus right now ever lives to make intercession for us. Hebrews 7:25.
Yeah.
And in Romans 8 chapter says he will not bring condemnation against you. He is for you. He will not be against you.
Amen.
So when you call on the name of Jesus, you are calling on the one who's for you. Mm. You are calling on the one who already shed his blood and took his blood to the altar in heaven. It's applied there. It's a legal transaction where he brought you out of. It's already done. Once you put your faith in Jesus, you're putting your faith in the fact that you have been translated out of the power of darkness, out of the authority of the accuser, and you're brought over into the kingdom of light and love where God is on your side.
And that's Colossians 1:12.
Yes.
But if you go on 13 and 14, 13, it says, and in him we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sin. But the word there, forgiveness, in the King James is really the word for remission of sin. So now in Christ we have redemption, which means he purchased our freedom with his own blood. And in him we have it, present possession. In him we have redemption through his blood, even the remission of sin. So the word remission is a little stronger word than just forgiveness. The word remission means cancellation of penalty and the removal of guilt. So when he says in Christ we have the remission of sin, he says we are forgiven, but we're not just forgiven. Remission means that there is a cancellation of penalty and there is the removal of guilt, that you've been declared not guilty and the penalty has been canceled and you are righteous and redeemed by the blood of Jesus.
Wow. So you've gone from the Old Testament where God, he said, plead, let's plead together.
Mm-hmm.
And that's one level of redemption, you know, looking back. But now we have a better covenant based on better promises. And that word remission is now used.
Yeah.
It's better than forgiveness. What is in remission? What does that mean?
The remission of sin, actually, in Christ, we have a better covenant based on better promises, but still received by the same principles.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. So in other words, faith never changes. God's a faith God, Old Testament, New Testament. Faith works the same. It's just the object of our faith now in the new covenant is now a better sacrifice, which is the blood of Christ, which is the blood of his cross.
Mm-hmm.
So through what happened on the cross, the blood of Jesus, his death and resurrection, now through faith in his blood, through faith in his blood, we have the forgiveness, the remission of sin, which is more than just forgiveness. It is cancellation of penalty and the removal of guilt. Our one translation says we have absolute remission. And then earlier programs, we talked about molecular remission, where there's no evidence you ever had that situation in your life because of the power of the blood. It brings such great joy when a person realizes that you are redeemed by the blood of Jesus and you live in the consciousness of that blood and the confession of faith in that blood.
Yeah, I like that. It's so powerful, and it causes a continual victory.
Yeah.
And when we apply it, speak it, declare it, faith in the blood of Jesus, that's what faith is. It's believing, but it's an attitude, but it's also an action.
It gives you boldness and confession, confidence.
And you obtain the promise with your faith.
Speaking. And so the speaking part. Now, let's look at plead the blood real quickly here, because he said, I plead. And he says in Jeremiah chapter 2, verse 9, God said, I will yet plead with you and your children, I will plead. And then Lamentations 3:58, he says, O Lord, thou hast pleaded the causes of my soul, and you have redeemed my life. So let's look at the word plead real quickly here. So I looked up a definition of this years ago in Webster's 1828 dictionary. So let me read it to you, because it's a little bit repetitious, but that's what kind of makes it outstanding and interesting.
I like this one.
All right, here's what Webster's dictionary said on the word pleadings, which would be like in a legal sense, pleadings, the mutual altercations between the plaintiff and the defendant are written statements of the parties in support of their claims, comprehending the declaration, count, or narration of the plaintiff, the plea of the defendant in reply, the defendant's rejoinder, the plaintiff's sir rejoinder, the defendant's rebuttal, the plaintiff's sir rebuttal, etc. So that means there's like accusation, charges, and then there is the response, the rebuttal. And he said, and it goes back and forth. That's the pleadings. And then he says this, and that continues that process until the question is brought to issue, that is to rest on a single point. I like that part. In other words, the argument goes forward and backward until the question is brought to rest on a single point. And so the single point, he says, he brings that argument to an end and he rests his confidence and his case on a single point. So the pleadings, when you plead the blood, you're simply saying, I rest my case on a single point. The issue is not what I did or did not do. Now, my case rests on what the blood of Jesus has done for me in heaven, what it does over Satan, what that blood does in my own heart, in my own conscience. So I rest my case. And when you rest your case, that means your faith has entered into rest. I rest my case. I'm no longer struggling or fighting. I believe God, and I speak and declare my confidence, and my confession is through faith in the blood of Christ.
Watching Mark Hankins Ministries, Faith for Every Nation. Do you want to live an overcoming life? Do you want to have more confidence in your prayer life? Never let your struggles become your identity. Through faith in the blood of Jesus, we can live in the reality of our redemption. In the new 4-CD series, The Precious Blood of Jesus, Pastor Mark Hankins teaches on understanding how the blood of Jesus silences the voice of sin and condemnation. How Jesus paid for your redemption with his blood. He paid too high a price for your victory for you to be defeated. not only will we clearly see what the precious blood of Jesus has done for us, but also what it does in us as believers. Along with this new CD set, you'll get the book, The Bloodline of a Champion. Mark Hankins explains the power of the blood of Jesus. This book has a brand new chapter about his grandson Dylan and how he overcame leukemia and a bone marrow transplant. Faith in the blood of Jesus can help us live in the reality of our redemption, which gives real solutions to real people for real problems. By faith, we're part of a new bloodline, the bloodline of a champion. Order this special package today. Your gift of $20 or more will help Pastor Mark and Trina Hankins train believers around the world. Call 318-767-2001 or visit markhankins.org.
Thank you so much for joining us for the program today. I love to hear my parents talk about the power of the blood of Jesus, because so many people don't realize what happened when Jesus shed his blood. So much is done and so much that we have because of the blood. There's so many benefits that we have because of the blood. So this teaching will help you understand all the things that you have access to because of that blood. This week's offer is The Bloodline of a Champion. I encourage you to get this book. It's going to help you to see and to understand everything that you can have and everything that you have through the blood covenant of Jesus Christ. I encourage you, get the book, share it with a friend. It will help you. Until next time, I'm Alicia.
Mark and Trina Hankins for an hour of powerful teaching live Monday through Friday on Facebook and YouTube at 10 a.m. Central Standard Time. Everyone can join In Christ Bible School. Catch the spirit of faith and move the mountains in your life. Watch live wherever you are and learn who you are in Christ. That's live at 10 a.m. Central Standard Time.
Thank you for watching Mark Hankins Ministries' Faith for Every Nation.